Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents REV, Resolve, by T.R. Harris. Narrated by Keith Sellon-Wright. Chapter 1. A dozen dark figures with black skin and black uniforms slithered down the steep rock face of the cliffs to either side of the huge hydroelectric dam. They moved with uncanny speed and confidence, their two-inch-long retractable claws on their hands and feet providing traction on the hard granite surface. Even if sound could be heard above the din of the water cascading from the spill ducts, there would be none coming from the commandos. Stealth was their strength, their weapon. They climbed down past the roadway that crossed the towering edifice until they were about 20 feet below the top. Here, matching metal walkways snaked along the concrete facade and wound down to the structure's base, with doorways periodically leading into the interior. The dam was much more than a barrier to hold back the millions of cubic miles of water forming Lake Rise's azure wonder. Within its relatively narrow breadth, a variety of pipes and tubing fed the 16 whirling electric generators that provided power for the city of 5 million located 8 miles farther downriver, as well as for much of the farmland and scattered manufacturing plants of the surrounding plains. Some of the electricity even made it to the coast and the series of sprawling metropolises along the bluffs and sandy beaches. Now the dam served as the hunting grounds for the alien Hakurn, cat-like creatures from a lost world over 1,400 light-years away. The metal doors leading to the interior were no challenge for the aliens, and within moments of reaching their target destinations, the slender, dark figures disappeared inside the structure. The various spotlights that lit the sheer concrete barrier now showed no movement, as was expected at 2 in the morning. Once inside, the dual teams moved efficiently to the lower levels. The base was thicker here, but the ordnance the aliens carried would be enough to do the job. Besides, the Hakurn knew precisely where to go and where to place the charges. To their disappointment, they only encountered a handful of lethargic security guards during their mission. They would have preferred more, but their mission was not to directly engage the enemy. They were tasked with simply entering and exiting the structure by the appointed time. Within 12 minutes of appearing on the mountain ridges, the Hakurn were back at their high perches overlooking the dam and the moonlit lake to the east, sitting back on their haunches and swaying slightly from side to side. The sway was an instinctive reaction signifying anticipation of a future action. Most of the black aliens were salivating, even though this pack had reached the point where they would no longer face the possibility of physical combat with an enemy. Still, they knew what was coming, and this was the moment the species lived for, the point of execution. Ahmed Wadi knew he shouldn't be here. It wasn't his job to be on the planet with a battle about to begin. He was the commander of the REV forces, and as such, his place was back on the battle carrier Valhalla, directing the action on the surface, not being part of it. But he was also an Alpha Rev, and the cascading he was experiencing made his body tingle with excitement. If anything, he wanted to smell the smoke from the battlefield, experience the thunder of exploding ordnance, and revel in the thrill of his savage horde ripping alien flesh apart, often with their bare hands. He wanted to be there with his troops, and perhaps, if he had the opportunity, he would partake in a little bloodletting of his own. It was still early. Who knew where the fortunes of war would take him? Colonel Ahmed Wadi had taken over command of the REV forces after his predecessors, General Zach Murphy and Colonel Angus Price, were recalled to Earth. That was 6 months ago, and since then there had been a dramatic shift in tactics employed to facilitate the incorporation of new worlds into the Union of Affiliated Systems, the UAS, Earth's burgeoning stellar empire. This change came through the direction of the CFC, the Combat Force Committee, more commonly referred to by the grunts as the Clusterfuck Committee. The Consolidated Diplomatic Corps directed this 16-person panel of civilian, military, and government personnel under the auspices of the Outer Reaches Settlement Committee on the planet Joris. Each of these various entities answered ultimately to Earth and the UAS Expansion Committee of the World Congress in Rockville, Maryland. It may seem like a long and convoluted chain of command. However, the CFC had considerable latitude when it came to accomplishing the goals set forth by Congress. As long as the stats showed a steady increase in the number of affiliated systems added within a specified accounting period, the CFC could do pretty much what it wanted. So far, the goals had been met and often exceeded. Because of this, CFC Director Elliot Bell was the shiny new thing in the halls of government, and Ahmed knew the senior diplomat was determined to keep it that way. That was why the Qadar campaign was going to be one for the record books, and why Ahmed was on the surface, ready to give the order to execute. He didn't want to miss a thing. Ahmed had been a major in the REV Corps when Murphy was in command, so he knew how much things had changed. In Murphy's 10 years in charge, he was under the direction of the old Armada and the Diplomatic Corps operating within the Outer Reaches. At that time, their actions were slower, more deliberate. Often it would take 6 months or more to subdue a resisting species. It was more important to preserve the infrastructure of the world rather than score a quick capitulation. That changed with Murphy's recall and the transfer of power to the CFC. Now it was a numbers game, with the people of Earth addicted to the idea of an ever-growing stellar empire destined to one day rule the galaxy. At one time, that was only the domain of science fiction, but under Bell's leadership, it could someday become a reality. Granted, that was still generations away, but if the CFC had anything to do with it, and they did, it would happen sooner rather than later. "The Hekkern are in position, Colonel," Ahmed's adjutant reported. The command staff was in a heavily armed tank-like vehicle proceeding through a section of the huge alien city that had been recently abandoned by the civilian natives and accompanied by a squad of 9 other APCs. They were in a hurry to get to high ground before the offensive began. Ahmed knew the game plan, so not much would surprise him, even the complete 180 his superiors had made regarding combat operations. In one way, he was glad that his troops wouldn't be bogged down on any one planet for long. In another, he missed the days of prolonged engagements with more opportunities for his REVs to be REVs. "Very well, Major. Start the countdown. Inform the Valhalla. We light the candle in 60 seconds. The planet Qadar was a typical Earth-standard world, now designated ES-102, with humanoid natives sporting fur-covered bodies and a small tail. The tail appeared through slits in their clothing and helped with balance as they ran. They were much faster than normal humans, but not REVs or Hekkern. The Malim, as the natives called themselves, rated 6.9 in the Blood Book, placing them equivalent to early 20th century technology on Earth. They had projectile weapons, rockets, and aircraft, but no nuclear weapons. The fact that they resisted the offer to join the UAS surprised Ahmed. They had a lot to gain with membership. But some species valued independence more than their future well-being. Ahmed seldom concerned himself with the politics of a situation, but now that he was in command, it was hard to avoid. Director Elliot Bell of the CFC had approached the Malim after they refused to submit and offered them the standard remedy. Rather than destroy the planet in a prolonged and senseless war, the natives should designate one city where the combatants would engage. Both parties would agree to abide by the results of the campaign. At first, it didn't seem possible that a more primitive race could defeat a star-faring empire. But it was then pointed out that all the humans would be sending into the battlefield would be a few thousand REVs and alien Hekkern, while the natives could supply millions of fighters if they wished. It seemed like a win-win for the natives, especially since Bell promised to use only ground troops and no superior technology. Ahmed knew better. The city of Solim was located in the gradual, sloping highlands of the Rice Mountains, terraced on the slopes and overlooking the vast, fertile plains to the west. The mountains towered high above, with a narrow river valley snaking through the range formed by the flow of the ancient Rice River. A dam tamed the raging river 150 years before, and now the river meandered through the lower third of the city to the south, forming some of the most expensive and sought-after real estate in the area. Here, stately manors lined the shores, while some of Kedar's most prestigious companies and institutes of higher learning occupied huge campuses never too far from the riverbank. Nearly all civilians were gone from the area by now, anxious to leave before the start of hostilities with the invaders from the stars. First Commander Wes Kinnett and his regiment had taken over one of the most luxurious resort complexes along the river. He was on the roof of the 14-story building, looking through a set of spyglasses at the city to the north. Shuttles had been landing in the central part of Solim for over an hour, and Kinnett knew the humans were moving in their so-called super soldiers to counter the 1 million-plus Malim troops already in place. Kinnett was an experienced combat officer, so he faced the enemy troop placements with a degree of skepticism. The Malim forces manned a line of bastions in south and north Solim, with the central region left open as a lure to the invaders from the stars. The humans fell for the trap, moving most of their combat troops into that part of town. On cue, the vice would close, crushing the few thousand aliens in that part of the city. The simplicity of the plan made Kinnett nervous. The aliens were intelligent and skilled warriors. They had to know their tenuous position. However, they continued to pour into central Solim. Did they have such confidence in their super soldiers? Did arrogance and overconfidence govern their actions? The first commander wasn't sure. But on the other side of the equation, the Malim were fighting for their home world. They would not go quietly into the night. This battle was supposed to guide all other negotiations with the invaders. It would have been good to see the humans in action before this. But the one saving grace Kinnett had was the knowledge that another 1 million combat troops were on standby outside the city. Even if the first round of engagements went horribly wrong for the Malim, they would not give in. There was no time limit for the campaign, and no limit as to the number of troops his people could employ. He sighed. Once the battle began, Kinnett would know better how to deploy his assets. He had the resources of an entire planet to draw from. Surely, victory would be theirs. And yet, the humans had expanded this far from their home world of Earth using this tactic of limited engagements. They had to know their odds for victory. And still they came, and with only by these things called REVs. Rumors of these warriors were rampant on Klaenor. Although the Malim had not developed star travel at the time of the alien contact, stories had filtered in since that momentous event. Kinnett and his people didn't have much time to adapt to the idea of alien life beyond their home world before demands were being dictated and fatal decisions had to be made. Watching the fiery entry trails of the human shuttles, Kinnett wondered if it might have been better to acquiesce to their demands. All the aliens wanted was for Klaenor to enter their union. Perhaps that would not have been such an offensive alternative to what was about to happen in Solim. But Kinnett was a soldier, tasked with defeating the enemy, and at all costs. The future engagement, for as long as it took, was a winner-take-all proposition. Therefore, the first commander would sacrifice every resource to assure victory for his people and his planet. Once the humans knew the Malim would not readily submit to their demands, then perhaps negotiations could begin for a more equitable affiliation of the races. But at the moment, the invaders had to be repelled, and that would involve a complete defeat of the enemy in the city of Solim. The Hekkern had once been Earth's enemy, siding with the evil Antari toward the end of the 30-year-long human-Antari war. However, they had been reluctant allies of the yellow-skinned bastards, forced to fight for them under threat of destruction of their home world, Falmoria Kra, through the use of hundreds of powerful nuclear weapons buried in secure bunkers under the surface. After the defeat of the Antari, the Hekkern were free to choose their allies. And although humans and Hekkern would never be considered friends, the cat-like creatures decided to fight alongside the humans as a means of satisfying their instinctual lust for battle. And they especially liked working with the REVs, who were more their equals in individual combat, although one would be hard-pressed to find a Hekkern who would admit it. But recently they'd grown tired of working directly with the humans, and now maintained a small fleet of their own in the outer reaches. They still performed operations with the humans, answering to the same combat force committee as the REVs, but with their own chain of command and engaging in separate missions during campaigns. From atop the rocky canyon wall overlooking the dam, the Hekkern squad leader received the execute order. He anxiously fingered a switch on a data pad, and thunder and lightning suddenly erupted from the steep sides of the dam. Massive slabs of concrete broke away, followed instantly by torrents of water shooting out from the breaches. These singular points only lasted a few seconds before more of the structure came apart. Now, a glimmering waterfall of crystal blue water poured through the dam, lit by the dual moons of Klaenor. Waves surged up rock walls farther down the canyon, stripping away everything in their path. It would take weeks to drain the lake completely. But by then, a third of the city of Solim would be gone. First Commander Wes Kinnett received the panicked report, having to stop the near-incoherent messenger several times before he grasped its full meaning. He was still on the roof of the hotel, only minutes away from giving the order for the two main Malum forces to begin closing the vice on the alien invaders. Now, his focus was singularly on the message he'd just received. The Rise Dam had collapsed. Two thoughts immediately filled his mind. The first, this was not a coincidence. The humans did this and directly violated pre-engagement protocols. The dam was beyond the boundaries of Solim and therefore off-limits. The second was the dread of knowing that a flood of raging water was only minutes from his location. The hotel sat on the banks of the Rise River. Not only that, but the entire western section of Solim was in the floodplain for the river. No one thought much of that these days, not after the dam had been built. But now? Kinnett pulled up the city's topographical map that he carried in a small electronic reader the Tex had given him. He was still getting used to using the device, but it was better than having to lug reference books and maps around with him. Two yellow sections signified the parts of the city controlled by the Malum troops. A green area lay in the middle. He gasped when he studied the elevations of the three-tiered town, having to steady himself against the railing on the roof before two non-officers stepped up to help him. His knees had gone weak. Kinnett had 500,000 troops under his command, and except for a small fraction of them, they were positioned deep in the western sector of Solim. The rise from this part of the city to the more protected terraces was rather drastic. He would order his troops to evacuate to the north, but with the few minutes left before the arrival of the flood, it wouldn't be enough time for them to get to higher ground. "First Commander, aircraft are coming to evacuate the command staff," said his side hand. "Please step back from the railing. The craft will need room to land." Kinnett was guided to a protected part of the roof where the rotor wash wouldn't cast him over the side of the building. A few seconds later, two blade craft landed. Shouted commands sent the designated officers and others to the loading doors, including the first commander. They were airborne 2 minutes later. Orders had gone out for all southern troops to head for the central region to seek higher ground. Those who made it that far would be fair game for the waiting human animals. Half of the Malum force would be gone in the next 5 minutes. After that, could First Commander Ola Persson and her troops stop the aliens from overrunning their positions? Everyone would be in shock and demoralized over the loss of a third of the city and half of the initial defense force. Would the will to fight remain? Kennet considered calling in the reserves. But would the humans be expecting this and already have made preparations? Would he be throwing more lives away if he did so? From Kennet's high vantage point in the aircraft, he looked out at the city lights to the east. It was nighttime, and although he couldn't see the approaching wave, he could see its progress as entire neighborhoods and city blocks were going black. The scene was nightmarish. Moments later, Kennet's mouth hung open loosely, his eyes unblinking as the wave washed below him, continuing its relentless journey to the plains. The waters began to spread out, and although they were slowing down, the weight of the moving water was still enough to wash away 90% of the structures it encountered. Fires started somehow, and now several floating buildings blazed in the gloom of the night. Combined with the fires, the moons of Klaenor lit the scene below enough for him to see the shimmering, almost hypnotic flow of the flood. Kennet looked to the north. His aircraft was circling the city to the west, heading for the northern sector of Solim. He would meet up with Persson for the remainder of the battle to come. He was in shock and drained of energy. Until he recovered, he wouldn't be much help to his counterpart. Perhaps his growing anger toward the aliens would refocus his resolve and stamina. Humans did this, and at one time he thought of negotiating with the heartless beasts, becoming part of their union. Now Kennet realized the invaders had no honor. They had lied. What other promises would they betray? Kennet gnashed his teeth. There would be no peace after this, at least not for him, even if his superiors petitioned for such. He would not let the betrayal of the humans stand. From this moment forward and until the day he died, the creatures from Earth would be his mortal enemy, revenge against them his only purpose in life. Chapter 2. Lieutenant Marcus Stokes stood in the APC's observation scuttle, binoculars pressed to his face, helping his already enhanced REV eyesight. The glasses had night vision capabilities, but Stokes didn't bother with it. He could see perfectly well in the dim moon glow, scattered street lights, and the dancing of occasional fires floating in the rapidly moving debris. The flood had already rushed through the riverbed, overflowing the banks and taking out most of South Solim. Now the waters were expanding, chasing the panicked Malum natives up the hill toward his position. They came on foot, as well as in every form of mechanical transport they could find, racing headlong for the terraced highlands of central Solim. Stokes was ready for this, as were the 1,500 REVs stationed along the boundary between the city sections. And now they braced for the desperate life-or-death surge of between 10 to 20,000 native soldiers as they sought higher ground. Out of the 500,000 Malum troops that had occupied the lowlands, these were the soldiers stationed at barriers nearby, designed to keep the alien invaders out of their territory. Now the roles had been reversed. From his vantage point at the top of the ridge, Stokes saw them coming. His REVs were stationed within a row of stately residences that enjoyed an inspiring and unobstructed view to the south. There were very few roads in this section of town that coursed straight up the hill. Most were made up of gradual switchbacks, affording travelers some of the best views in the city. The wealthy inhabitants of the various neighborhoods were seldom in a rush. They could enjoy their fortune's trappings with a scenic drive up or down the terrace. Now, Lieutenant Stokes and his troops had excellent line-of-sight firing positions above the winding roads. The main thoroughfares were already blocked off, making beeline travel to higher ground impossible. Soon the killing would begin, and there would be a lot of it. Command had anticipated such a scenario after the dam was blown, moving the first landing troops into strategic positions to the south of the sector. Lieutenant Stokes's platoon of 60 REVs was one among dozens of others along the ridge. The battle for Claynor was about to begin. Stokes had been an enlisted Marine before volunteering for the REV program, reaching the rank of E-7 Gunnery Sergeant by the time the war was over. He'd fought in his share of campaigns against the Antari, and that experience gave him a direct line to the REV Officer Corps. The Running Man Brigade was in desperate need of officers since most of the recruits coming in from Earth were still of questionable quality. On the home world, REVs were still persona non grata, so most of those volunteering for the program were the dregs of society, criminals and other miscreants given the choice of prison or the REV Corps. It was an easy choice. With the new AC3 version of the REV drug, most candidates would qualify, and then a high percentage of the Bravos would make the transition to full-blown Alphas. At that point, they would no longer require outside help to activate, nor did they need periodic maintenance boosts. They were natural REVs at that point, producing the performance-enhancing drug themselves. Most of the REV Corps had no prior military background. However, their unique abilities made them naturals at combat. But they still required training, and that's where people like Lieutenant Marcus Stokes came in. He was Marine through and through, and also being a REV, he understood the difference between being a traditional Marine and a REV Marine. The differences were shocking. Every physical aspect of his REV body was enhanced, making him easily 5 times better than an average human. His reaction time, eye-to-hand coordination, and decision-making were off the chart. Besides that, he could also take multiple hits from alien ballistic weapons, and in most instances be able to continue the fight, after which his rapid healing abilities would have him up and raring to go in a matter of days. His sense of pain was also lessened, and he seldom grew tired. Marcus Stokes was one of the rare REVs who could fully appreciate what he had become. He savored the changes. He didn't take them for granted nor boast of his superiority as so many of the enlisted REV had a habit of doing. REV gave a new life, and Lieutenant Stokes relished every moment of it. He shifted his gaze to the line of waiting REVs. Most were equipped with M42 advanced assault rifles, commonly called zingers, while others carried RPG launchers or sat in machine gun nests. The kill ratio would be staggering and in favor of the REVs. All they had to worry about was whether or not they'd have enough ammo. From personal experience, Stokes also knew his troops were anxious for some good old-fashioned hand-to-hand combat. That's when a REV's true superiority manifested. In his 9 months in the REV fleet, he'd experienced his share of such action. It was exhilarating, tossing aliens about like rag dolls, fighting them as if they moved in slow motion, and with their fragile bodies seemingly made of papier-mâché. But that wasn't the most efficient way to fight a war in this day of advanced technology. Even so, he, like his men, hoped for at least one opportunity to take on a native one-on-one. "Ready up," he said into his command mic. "Let the cars get up the hill before opening fire. Then the wreckage will block the roads for other vehicles. Let them then come on foot. But remember, these guys are fast bastards. Be ready for some fancy broken field running. Conserve your ammo. We have a lot, but there are a lot of the natives heading our way. The waters should rise to within a couple of 100 meters of our elevation, so the battle shouldn't last long. Don't waste ammo on targets farther out than that. Let the water do the work. All right. Let's show these aliens what it's like to go up against REVs." Stokes heard cries of "Oorah!" rise up near the APC, knowing that the battle cry of the Marines was happening all along his line. The sudden roar of hundreds of weapons filled the night. Rockets trailed out, and the constant high-pitched song of zinger rounds buzzed like a million bees in flight. Explosions rose from below and along the various winding bands of paved and landscaped roadways leading up the hill. Stokes watched as metal shredded and body parts flew away. Some natives opened fire, while others had forgone all military discipline and were simply running for their lives from the rapidly rising waters to their back. Even holding the high ground and with a force of super warriors, the sheer number of natives coming up the hill was overwhelming. Incoming gunfire shattered the ornate stone walls of the estates, with many of Stokes' REVs taking more hits than even their enhanced bodies could handle. Soon it became apparent that this section of the terraces was the preferred path up the hill, funneling thousands of desperate soldiers against Stokes' rapidly declining numbers. Still, the number of dead aliens was staggering. Even so, eventually, they crested the summit. Stokes had the APC moving back along the wide streets of this exclusive neighborhood, his gunner firing nonstop at the surge of Malum, most on foot, with a few having commandeered discarded vehicles once owned by the now missing inhabitants of the neighborhood. But the natives didn't need the cars. They were fleet of foot, some of the fastest aliens Stokes had ever encountered, using their tails to help them perform logic-defying 90-degree turns at full speed. For an average human, hitting one of these elusive targets on flat land would have been difficult, if not impossible. The REVs had an easier go of it, but there were just so many of them.
"Unit 39 Golf to command," Stokes called into his microphone.
He was buttoned up inside the APC by now, watching through the thick bulletproof windows as the natives sprinted by. Many shot at the armored vehicle with little effect.
"Position overrun. Pulling back to map grid section 123 Hotel Echo. Force down to approximately 20, maybe less. Please advise."
The response was immediate.
"Unit 39 Golf, hold at 123 Hotel Echo. Support troops moving in from your flanks. They experienced less enemy action. Relief is on the way."
"Roger that. Stokes out."
The APC suddenly jerked up and flipped over, resulting from a powerful rocket round hitting under the forward motor compartment. A battery pack exploded, taking out the driver and the head gunner. Fortunately, the vehicle was electric and carried no flammable fuel. But Lieutenant Stokes did find himself scrunched against the ceiling while two other surviving REVs kicked open a side door and pulled him from the vehicle. The three Marines scrambled for the cover of a nearby tree just as another rocket impacted the exposed underbelly of the APC. The concussion threw the humans back onto the cool, moist grass. The two enlisted REVs had their M42 zingers out, the supersonic rounds slicing dozens of aliens in half at near point-blank range. Stokes took out his Officer Regulation 45 caliber handgun and began popping off at any native within range. He went through one magazine before inserting another. That was when three of the hairy natives jumped on his back. One had a knife, and he slid it over Stokes's right forearm. The skin opened up, but not as much as the Malum expected. The officer lashed out with the bloody limb, crashing it into the alien's exposed face, crushing the short snout deep into the skull. He then dropped his shoulder, flipping the other two natives off his back. He was on his feet a moment later, squared off against the pair. Fiery, dark eyes stared back at him, and the natives growled. He'd seen the Blood Book report on the natives, so he knew they weren't savages. But in the heat of battle, they acted like they were. They attacked in unison. The natives were quick, but not as quick as a REV. Stokes twisted his body sideways, allowing one of the aliens to slip by. The other crashed into the human's body, which braced for the attack. The Malum stopped in his tracks as if he'd hit a wall. Stokes didn't give him time to regroup. He still had the 45 cal in his right hand. He smashed it against the native's head, sending another one of the hairy beasts to the ground, dead. The other Malum had spun around using his balancing tail and now tackled Stokes from behind. Skillfully, the lieutenant rolled over, taking the alien with him.
The savage look was still on the hairy face. Now,
we hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.